death cap mushroom, Amanita phylloides, is a recently arrived immigrant from Europe, and it is of great concern. It's the most deadly mushroom in the world. It kills more people than any other fungus, or any other mushroom. And it's got complex toxins visible at the upper left. And it happens to grow around the time of Halloween, especially. So we have a Halloween picture at a death cap location. Okay, Amanita phylloides causes the most mushroom fatalities. The toxins are called amatoxins, and they're cyclopeptides. Other mushrooms contain these toxins, including the white amanitas called destroying angels, and little brown mushrooms called canosidae and gallerina, and little white mushrooms called lepiota. The poisoning is insidious in that it takes a long time for first symptoms to come on, up to 6 to 12 or 36 hours after eating the mushroom. By the first symptoms, the mushroom material and toxins are fully absorbed to not be eliminated from the system. The symptoms are severe gastrointestinal, including colicky, abdominal pain, vomiting, watery diarrhea. And after about 1 day of these initial symptoms, there's a false remission in which the patient is often assumed to have recovered. And then after approximately 72 hours post-ingestion, a second wave of symptoms comes on. This is often the terminal stage where organ damage is sufficient to cause coma and ultimately death. And usually in most fatalities, death occurs in approximately 1 week. It is a very slow and unpleasant demise. Not that any demises are quick and pleasant. It is native to Europe. It is an ectomycorrhizal mushroom. And as Steve explained, ectomycorrhizal mushrooms grow with trees. The trees are dependent upon the fungus. The fungus is dependent upon the tree. Therefore, these things are getting around not by transportation of spores, but by transportation of host trees. This is how they are getting around. In Europe, these grow with both conifers and broadleaf trees, especially in the plant families Pinaceae and the broadleaf trees and the Betulaceae and Fagaceae. They have been introduced into other parts of the world from Europe, and now they are in many parts of Asia, temperate parts of Asia, southern Africa, southern South America, Australia, New Zealand, and North America. Wherever there are temperate forests and temperate environments for trees, these things have invaded. In North America, it was first found in California in 1938. It was found in Oregon in 1959. First found in Washington State in 1978. And first found in British Columbia in 1997, approximately a two-decade interval between jurisdictions. This may not reflect the time of movement of the fungus into those areas, but rather the maturation rate of trees. As you get further from warm climates, trees take longer to mature, which I will speak of. Here's just a graphic example of the ectomycorrhizal relationships. The mushrooms, mycelia, are intimately engaged with the rootlets of the tree. And the tree stores up and manufactures and stores up enough sugars to produce the fruiting bodies of the mushroom, which is rather energetically expensive for the mycelium, so it needs a certain amount of sugar to create these fleshy fruiting bodies. This is the first specimen of death cap to be found in British Columbia. It had an adventure, Italian-Canadian man by the name of Marco Pelizzari went to a stand of very old sweet chestnut trees to collect nuts. The Vancouver Mycological Society had become alarmed as there were reports of Amanita phalloides fatalities coming from California, Oregon, and Washington. And so we put out word to the membership, showed them pictures of what the Amanita phalloides looked like, and we asked them to spread the word to anybody they know that likes to gather mushrooms or to keep an eye out for Amanita phalloides. And that fall, this Italian-Canadian man collecting his chestnuts at the family spot for them, recognized the Amanita phalloides, passed it on to a member of the club, who passed it on to another member, who passed it on to another member, and I eventually received the solitary specimen after about a week, and perhaps a dozen pairs of hands having passed it from one to another, documented them. These chestnut trees probably date from the 1920s at the formation of Iroquois community and mission with the railroad coming through. It took a while for these communities to build. Grain production wasn't practical at that time, so sweet chestnut was used as a flower substitute. Very popular tree. We haven't yet tracked down the origin of the tree stock in that area, though the records are probably there buried somewhere. Now, after 1997, the immediate year following, Amanita phalloides was found at Government House in Victoria under a tree that our documentation tells us was planted in 1906 that originated from Larratt's nursery in Saanich, Vancouver Island. And shortly within a decade after this, we had accumulated several locations. British Columbia, and there are several others around Victoria, especially under oak, linden, and hornbeam trees. These are all non-native. Associated with developments which are dateable, so there is one from 1912, then there is a neighborhood that built up, the neighborhood of Uplands was built from 1912 on, and tree stock from Larratt's nursery apparently was planted on the streets in that development. There was a planned community. And then there is another place, Crystal Gardens, where they were found. And that, we know, was landscaped in 1925 from plant stock. So we have there a clue as to the origin of these mushrooms. In year 2008, the first Amanita phalloides were found in Vancouver City. And by 2013, we knew of seven locations, and only one of these was not a hornbeam tree. These were all city street trees planted by the City of Vancouver Parks Board. In 2014, it was found growing on Galliano Island, one of the goofy Gulf Islands that is between Vancouver Island and the mainland, and evidently with hazelnut, the European hazelnut. 2015, it was found growing under a native Gary Oak tree in Saanich. Very important finding. Shannon Birch here was one of the, was the finder of that alarming find. And so far, there have been three poisonings in BC attributed to BC Amanita phalloides. And one of them was fatal last year. A young child died. Who ate mushrooms from Victoria. That was our first death from native-grown Amanita phalloides. There was a case, apparently, of an adult man who was visiting California, ate mushrooms in California, came back, and developed symptoms and died of classic amatoxin poisoning, but he'd eaten them in California. So that doesn't count. Here are the tree species thus far associated with Amanita phalloides in British Columbia. These are all broadleaf tree species, and all but one of them are not native to Canada, or to Western Canada. So we have the hornbeam, sweet chestnut, European hazelnut, or filbert, European beech, the Gary oak, which is native, English oak, red oak, and linden trees, which are very common street trees. Here, worldwide, are just a few of the host trees, and I have highlighted in some color there trees that are part of our native forest woodlands. And several of the conifers. So far, no conifers have been found associated with death towns. But if they are capable of transferring from broadleaf to conifers, or if we get a strain that lives with conifers on the East Coast, yes. And it appears to be a different population of Amanita phalloides associated with conifers. But if we get that one, or if somehow the transfer could be made, we could be in big trouble with them entering our native forests. We already have lots of birch trees. Well, fortunately, the birch are dying out from various pathologies now. I might add that filbert and hazelnut are dying out massively from eastern hazelnut blight. So that may be eliminated as a host species. But otherwise, we have potential for widespread occurrence of these things in native habitat. Here's a few examples of how people get into trouble. In 2003, a Victoria man picked and ate what he thought were puffballs growing in his front yard in Oak Bay, the district of Victoria. They're actually young death cap buttons. And when Brenda Callan later went to the site, she found much to her aghast that they were actually Amanita phalloides, and they'd opened up and matured, no longer looked like puffballs. This is a familiar scenario in two ways. A, people for some really silly reason will eat things in their own property or close to where they live that they wouldn't otherwise eat. And this happens over and over again. Anybody that does mushroom identification for multiple possible poisoning gets these questions. I found a mushroom in my backyard and I ate it. Did I make a mistake? Why did you eat it? Well, it was in my backyard. And you ask, well, did you eat cats that wander through your backyard? Do you eat the shrubs and flowers in your backyard? For some reason people do that. And then it is a classic error that people mistake the young Amanita phalloides buttons for puffballs because they look very much like some puffballs. Poisoning number two, a woman of Southeast Asian origin. She was Korean, from South Korea. Ate Amanita phalloides, mistaking them for straw mushrooms, a popular cultivated edible species of Southeast Asia, where traditionally they did not have Amanita phalloides. This is a very common familiar mushroom to those from that part of the world, and it's quite a delightful edible. This is another very familiar scenario of people from that part of the world that are immigrants to other parts of the world mistaking the deadly death cap mushroom for the straw mushroom. She picked them around 200th Street and 16th Avenue in Langley in the Fraser Valley. This is an aerial photograph. And on the upper right corner is part of the City of Vancouver Parks Board tree farm, where city street trees are field planted for a few years before they're outplanted into the final location. To the right of the photograph, the intersection of the road up here is what she gave eventually as the location where she picked these from a friend's farm, evidently. This whole left side of the image are either disused or still active ornamental tree farms. And that area has a long tradition. Decades before the City Parks Board bought up the tree farm that they use now, that had already been agricultural land used for propagation of ornamental trees. This may be a clue as to the origin of our Vancouver death camp. And we had a heck of a time getting information on the location and situation of this poisoning because, A, the woman did not speak English and family members had to translate, and she thought she had snuck onto land that she might not be allowed on, so she was very reticent to provide information thinking she might get into trouble, which is also a rather familiar scenario from certain incidents that happen. So we started a death cap survey by 2008. We found the first Vancouver Amanita phalloides 2008. By street trees to identify trees of the same size, carpinus or hornbeam trees of the same size or larger as the trees that, that were known to host the death camp. And we mapped them out. We found mass plantings through the city and assigned different of the volunteers from BMS to survey those areas. And currently, we know of more than 90 sites or individual tree hosts with Amanita phalloides in the city of Vancouver. That's a large number of locations. Only three of these are with trees other than hornbeam. We surveyed in the process of roaming all over the city looking for these. We had opportunity to look at lots of linden, mass plantings, oak, beech, etc. We didn't find any additional sites in the sometimes quite numerous plantings of these other potential hosts, as such as they're found in Victoria as hosts of death camps. So, in Vancouver, this mushroom is strongly associated with the hornbeam, ornamental hornbeam trees planted as street trees. We're able to track down the age of the trees to stock that was planted on the streets in the 1960s and early 70s. I'll explain that in a moment. We know that they weren't occurring with these trees until recently, and I'll explain that also. And this, the age of the trees, puts them at about 50 years, which is the point when this particular species of tree reaches its maximum height and crown width. So that means the tree has reached maturity. It's no longer investing a lot of its photosynthetic sugars in its own growth, so it develops surplus sugars, which can then support production of mushrooms. This is apparently unique in Vancouver. Hornbeam is noted as a host in the Victoria area. And now that it's being found in the Fraser Valley at one location under hornbeam. But the great prevalence in Vancouver of death cap associated with hornbeam is very strongly indicative of a fluke, an accident of introduction through horticultural tree, ornamental tree stock, probably from perhaps a single source. And at the time of planting in the 60s, hornbeam was a newly appreciated, very popular street tree. The city arborist loved hornbeam and thought it had great potential. This may be very useful in helping us to predict the distribution of the mushroom and to predict future spread and prevalence of it and to target certain areas for public information campaigns. Here is what the hornbeam looks like according to the Royal Horticultural Society. Now, this is what's called the horticultural fastigiata, a variety of hornbeam. It's a grafted top on other base, a hornbeam base. Now, often grafted quite low down on the ground, you get this bottle brush sort of appearance, shaving brush little appearance to the trees. They're very desirable for city street planting. They have many admirable qualities. This is what the mushroom looks like. The probably most distinctive characteristic is an olivey greenish color of the cap. The cap will be moist in wet conditions, but as the conditions dry out a little bit, they develop a distinctive satiny sheen above the cap. A satiny or sort of a bit of a metallic gloss. And this is quite distinctive. They grow often in lawn, turf, or sod around the trees, and they will be deeply sunk into that turf. So it's very easy to pick the mushroom and break off the stem. So you miss a very important characteristic, which is the death cup, as it is called. It develops enclosed in a membrane that protects it. Then as it grows, it splits apart, leaving a membrane at the base of the stem, cup-like membrane. And so it's very easy, unless you excavate the base, to miss that very important characteristic. And the color can be quite variable, from a very yellowy green to a dirty sort of olivey brown and gray. And they fade or change color with excessive rain or with sun exposure. But they have the annulus or ring around the top of the stem. And something that the first time I saw one, what struck me was that the stem has the cap color on the lower part of the stem and the underside of the ring, which is quite distinctive for amanitas in our part of the world. And white gills that are not attached to the stem top. And they're quite large in size. They're larger than the store-bought button mushroom, and often quite tall in stature. And we are dried out specimens from each new location, and they are deposited in the Beaty Museum, UBC Herbarium here. So we have a physical record of each and every location so far in Vancouver, and many of them have had the DNA sequence too. So we have a fingerprint of them. And eventually it may be possible to do fine level population genetics on them, we hope, and maybe solve a couple of mysteries of origin and distribution. Here is at one time what the distribution within Vancouver looked like. They're predominantly on the east side of the city of Vancouver. The east-west divider in Vancouver is close to Main Street here. And so East Vancouver is where most of them are. And that's because the traditionally more affluent western side of Vancouver had different tree species planted as predominant street trees and more expensive street trees. And East Vancouver used to be more working class, modest income, so less expensive trees were used. Here is how we figured out the age of our trees. The Vancouver City Parks Board tree database does not have planting year before 1989. Fortunately, there is a book called Vancouver, A Visual History, that has decade-by-decade maps showing the development of the city of Vancouver block by block. So every time a block changed, city block changed, from, say, undeveloped land to residential to apartment to commercial, it would be color-coded for that decade. And I superimposed locations of the death cap mushrooms, and here, and this is confidential information, is my house. And I live right next to Mountain View Cemetery. The first location in Vancouver is here. Second location here. I had lived in the house for 18 years before I found this location. I do most of my shopping. I'm a non-driver in Fraser Street Commercial District there. I had walked that route for 18 years before I saw the first death cap. This location is on the way to another shopping area that I frequent. And I'd walked by this location for 20 years before I first found the death cap. So we can say with fairly good certainty that these things were not common until approximately 2008, 2010. And then 2014, we began the survey and found lots of them. This is color-coded, so dark green is undeveloped land. Purple is industrial. There's dark green. Blue is institutional, so schools, etc. Yellow is houses, the single-family dwelling type thing. Orange is apartments and red is commercial, etc. So, this is the 1950s. So if we flash to the 1960s, the addition on undeveloped land suddenly looked quite different. And I'll draw your attention to this one too. This is a school. This is single family houses there. So here again, we see that these sites have been developed in the 1960s. And we know that one was 1961. This one went from both industrial and undeveloped to housing. And this one, this school expanded, and they tore down all sorts of single-family dwellings, redid the whole thing. And undoubtedly, that site was planted with the street trees following the development of that school annex. Here's the composition of city street trees. Over 60% of the trees planted in the city are not capable of hosting ectomycorrhizal mushrooms such as the amanita. These are maples, prunus, or the plums and cherries that are very popular flowering ornamental. And I have put in bold. Oh, sorry. Oh, that is irritating. Okay. So here are the tree species known as hosts for Amanita phalloides. They make up 15% of the city street tree stock, which is about 250,000 trees in the database. And of the other category, there's only very few of the hazelnuts and sweet chestnuts. They're not suitable street tree stock. There are about 2,000 hornbeams in the city that were planted before 1989 when the year of planting began to be listed. And of these, about 1,200 are 12 inches or more in diameter of breast height, which means that they're of a fairly suitable size and age to probably begin producing death cap mushrooms. By the time the trees have reached that point of maturity where they've attained full adult development, they also begin to produce lots of other ectomycorrhizal mushrooms. Looking at 20 or 25-year-old mass plantings of hornbeams, there's hardly anything growing under them. But once they've reached this age of about 50 years where they've maxed out their height and crown diameter, they begin producing a great diversity of mushrooms. And this is one reason we do not want to use a clear-cut approach to remove the host trees from the city. They're becoming a very important source of diversity within the city. They provide shade, all sorts of amenities that increase, that benefit human well-being by their presence there. And the number that are producing death cap mushrooms is far less than the ones producing other types of mushrooms. And here's an example of Amanita phalloides and Amanita muscaria, and the white variety and the red variety of muscaria under one tree. Amanita gemata, which we usually associate with conifers, grows abundantly under these hornbeam trees. And that's a native mushroom species. So a lot of native species are moving in with these trees, too. And we have the Amanita pantherinoides and the Cerustula species that are very prevalent under the hornbeam tree. And the population of mushrooms under hornbeam closely mimics birch tree, which used to be a popular street tree in Vancouver. And it looks, except for a couple of missing species, much like what you'd find under birch. And some popular good edible species grow under these trees too, such as Boletus edulis. The name edulis, by the way, is what we call a clue. It means that it's edible. And other things like scleroderma is poisonous, but mildly so. Gastrointestinal, people don't usually eat them. And there's quite a diversity, an impressive diversity of mushrooms that grow under these trees. So they're really valuable and pleasant to contribution to the health of our city. And the mushrooms are very important to maintain the health of the trees, not just the hornbeam, but other adjacent ectomycorrhizal trees to benefit from the presence of these mushrooms. Here are 12 mass plantings, some of the numbers involved. And a second column to the left indicates the number of trees in the mass planting. Then there are the trees that did not produce Amanita phalloides, the trees that did produce the Amanita phalloides, and then the percentage of trees in that mass planting affected by the Amanita phalloides. Here I've got a pretty colored graphic representation. Here it is represented. Here and here is the total column there. So we can see that out of 407 hornbeam trees, 15.6% produced Amanita phalloides. The much higher percentage produced Amanita muscaria, a much larger percentage produced other species of mushrooms. The phalloides was not the dominant mushroom. These are the sites that we were able to pin down to be planted in the 1960s. And here we've got a much higher percentage infected, almost 20%. And so I mentioned before that there are about 1,200 hornbeam trees in the database that are of a size sufficient to produce these at 20%. 1,200 trees produces phalloides. We have a picture of how prevalent these may be in the city if they only grow with hornbeam trees. Is it coming time? Okay. So, this is summary time. Now we have more than 115 death cap locations in BC, over 90 in Vancouver. Previous years, they're only found in very late summer and autumn. Last year was very unusual because they began to come up in June in both Victoria and Vancouver. July 18th, I found them growing under an English oak tree at the edge of Pacific Spirit Park, which is to the east of University here. And it's a native woodland that has escaped oak trees growing in it. So it could move into that woodland. And last year, it was proven that Amanita phalloides has indeed transferred to the native oak species. And in October, a three-year-old child died after ingesting Amanita phalloides, our first fatality for BC death cap. This points out the urgency of the situation now. We know that it is well established in urban and suburban areas of BC. Healthcare personnel have to be aware of this. They can expect to see more and more cases of Amanita phalloides in both humans and animals. Veterinarians should be concerned too. It is in urban environments, heavily populated. We can expect people to come into more and more frequent contact with them and pets also. Public education is going to be important. Seasonal public information warnings in various media may be useful in this. And something I would like to see is posting of little postcard-sized lawn signs in the areas of mass plantings that produce them with permission of the residents of the neighborhood. And these would be of sufficiently small size not to be intrusive. And anybody who would notice a mushroom would notice that's your little lawn sign. But it wouldn't be a big glaring thing. In most parts of North America, they have been found in parkland and woodland. So they post great big posters at entrance trails to parks. That would not work in our urban and suburban situation. We're dealing with a different approach here. And this would be important because to keep people from eating them, and then if toddlers, children, and pets do get into them, having the information there clearly indicating with pictures of the mushroom, it's just this type of mushroom, not all mushrooms, that type of mushroom. If somebody is worried about an ingestion by a child or pet, the response could be much faster. It could inform them, go to medical care immediately, and therefore we may prevent symptoms from developing, be able to prevent toxicity, even when there's been an ingestion. And help by continuing to report locations, build up a better picture of the spread of them, the increasing prevalence, and we can predict areas to These are a couple of examples which previously appeared in a talk this morning from a smaller group of some existing